Funding for NEOtropolis has been provided by the following.
Hello, I'm Lester Lefton. Kent State University is proud to sponsor NEOtropolis, a program that looks at the forces that impact the region. Kent State is one of those forces. As a center of educational excellence and as an economic development engine, our efforts at Kent State have a powerful and positive impact on the region through research and development, the arts and innovation, and preparing our graduates to compete in the global marketplace. I hope you enjoy the program, and I invite you to learn more about Kent State University.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, supporting transformational ideas that promote informed and engaged communities.
Hello, and welcome to NEOtropolis, the show about the forces of technology, globalization, diversity, how they impact our daily lives and affect how we live right here in Northeast Ohio. I'm your host, Luke Frazier. Tonight, we're going to consider the different languages of expression and how they are spoken in Northeast Ohio, from buses, spouting poetry in Portage County, to all digital fashion labs at Kent State. NEOtropolis is speaking in tongues to tell you all about the forces that affect your world. Tonight's episode is called The Languages of Expression. Of course, it's Valentine's Day. We all speak of love. I'll have more to say on that later. But there are all kinds of languages we use to express ourselves. We are the fashions we wear, the words we use, and the political rhetoric we spout with all its buzzwords. We are all about the message and the meaning live on the air tonight. But first, let's take a visit to the Wonder Wall. NEOtropolis' Wonder Wall is where we ask you, the viewers, a question to answer, maybe make a comment on. It has to do with the show we're working on tonight, like the languages of expression. So what we're going to do tonight is be joined by our social media expert, Kathleen. How are you?
Hi, Luke. Good,
excellent.
Thanks.
So listen, what is on the Wonder Wall tonight?
Tonight's question is all about freedom of expression. The question is, freedom of expression means tolerating some kinds of hate speech. Should burning crosses as part of a political rally be protected? It is, as you know. Should violent and sexually explicit video games be banned from arcades where there are teens? They aren't. What do you think?
That's a good one. That's a good one. So before we tell them how they can get in touch, do you have some social media tidbits tonight?
I do. Social media is made for self-expression. Perhaps even too much expression, you might think. Now, the collective realm of social media, and I'm talking about hundreds of social networks, not just Facebook and Twitter, they form our cultural landscape today. We now have numerous places to express ourselves. In the time it takes to watch this show, you can start a free blog site and begin composing your own musings about any topic in the world. Check out blogger.com or wordpress.com for those free sites. Now here in Northeast Ohio, we've got tons of people blogging. A few blogs you might want to check out, clevelandfoodie.com, which of course provides info about the dining scene. Broodfreshdaily.com focuses on politics and culture. And dogpounddaily.com talks about what else? The Cleveland Browns. Now in today's digital world, everyone has a soapbox with a megaphone that reaches around the world.
Absolutely true. So, cool. How can folks get in touch with the next 20 minutes?
As usual, we'd love to hear from you on facebook.com/NEOtropolisTV and live on Twitter at NEOtropolisTV and email us info@neotropolis.org.
Thank you. Thanks, Kathleen. We'll check with you at the end of the show.
Thanks, Luke.
Remember, we want to hear from you, too.
Be part of the conversation. Follow us on Twitter at NEOtropolisTV and on Facebook, YouTube, and Google+. When you visit neotropolis.org, check out the archives and sign up for our e-newsletter.
Let's start with poetry tonight. But in this case, it's not the leather-bound volumes of Shakespeare or the pages of an expensive magazine. It's on the Portage Area Regional Transit Authority bus through a program called Traveling Stanzas. Now you can groove to poetry while you're bumping and screeching along. On NEOtropolis, we take you lots of places, lots of different places, looking for the forces of technology and globalization and diversity. Today, we're in Kent. We're going to take you on a bus, but not just any bus, a poetry bus. Poetry, folks!
Yeah!
Poetry bus, excellent. But before we do that, We're going to talk to David Hassler. He's the director of the Wick Poetry Center here at Kent State. David, how are you?
I'm great. It's great to be here on the bus and be out here in this cold weather to talk about poetry.
So you're a poet administrator. Kind of, is that like the part of the job description?
Well, I don't really think of it so much as a job, but it's what I get paid to do. It's what I love to do. I'm a poetry lover, poetry administrator, poetry activist.
So tell me about this program, Traveling Stanzas. What is that all about?
This idea of putting poetry up above people's heads so that you can look up and pause and actually have that little pause in the day and read a poem and allow yourself to reflect and be taken somewhere. Really, this whole project, Traveling Stanzas, is a way to bring poetry to people's everyday lives and to increase the awareness of graphic design and poetry in our community and really promoting our own voices in our own community of all ages.
So are we ready for some poetry, folks?
Yeah!
Absolutely! All aboard!
Okay. Yeah!
On this bus, there's an explosion of poetry. Like David told us, Traveling Stanzas is a project connecting the community with its poetry. And on this bus, there's all kinds of verses. There are all kinds of text up on the where the ads usually are, except they're poems. And this is one kind of text you can read without getting a ticket while you're driving. So what we're going to do is talk to two of the poets who have poems on this bus. First, we're going to talk to Joe Steinhurst, and then after that, we're going to talk to Campbell Budzar. And if we're lucky, they'll read their poems for us. Joe, thank you for being with us today.
My pleasure.
And tell me about you. Have you been writing poetry for a long time?
Oh, I started as a teenager.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been writing off and on.
So you write poetry. What does that really mean to you? What does it do for you?
Poetry really exposes you. You're expressing what's in your heart. And so it's a way of expressing what you're feeling or what you'd like to feel. I think that it brings people closer to you. It gives them an understanding of who you are. And it makes you more aware of who you are.
Would you grace us by reading your poem that's here on the bus?
I'd love to. The title is Flags Are Flying. Today, flags are flying outside my window. 4th of July, and I am back in my parents' home, Boston, 1944. Flags were flying then, and not all red, white, and blue, but white ones too, with gold stars to signify broken hearts. I remember when the telegram arrived, just a piece of paper carrying tears for a wife, a fatherless child, parents in shock. Now, more than 60 years later, no telegram arrives, yet feelings remain for wasted lives, untimely end, while once again, flags are flying.
That's very beautiful, Joe. You know, that makes me think of that cycle, of course, that there are wars and conflicts from hundreds, thousands of years ago, and yet it goes on today.
Well, I was trying to express the futility of war in this poem.
And tell me the image there of the star in the window, the flag in the window, what is that about?
Well, during World War II, lots of people put out regular American flags hanging in from their windows. And then when young men started to die, white flags with gold stars were what was put out then to signify that there has been a loss in that family. In this particular poem, I used poetry to express my feelings all these years later that it doesn't go away. Sadness stays with you.
So, Campbell, you are a poet, and where do you go to school?
I go to Stanton Middle School.
And what grade are you in?
Seventh grade.
Oh, wow, okay. Campbell, first tell me, how'd you get interested in poetry?
I like to write. I like to imagine things and express myself.
So tell me about the poem that is on the bus here today. What's the name of it?
With All These Moments.
With All These Moments. And what is it about?
I wrote it when I was in third grade. And it was in this scrapbook of mine where I drew a lot of stuff in. And I think it had to do something with creating and imagining.
Creativity and imagination, two incredibly important things for writers and poets, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So would you do us the honor and read that poem for us?
Sure.
With All These Moments. With all these moments, which grew, then picked, and all those who shot, snapped, raced across, this time of floral grace. And those forgotten left behind a level of heart. And thee who ripened my moments, then sweetened and baked, as tender enough to eat. And those who greatened our moments and kneaded our bread and made such a difference.
Talking to Katie Barnes. Katie, what you were part of the graphic design team for which poem?
Flags Are Flying.
Mm-hmm. Is that Joe's poem?
Correct. And after I had gotten Joe's poem and really read it and read the subject matter, and then I actually even was so lucky to talk with Joe and really get to know what the subject matter was about, and it was such a serious, real subject that drove me to kind of going a completely different direction and using more real-looking graphics. After we had got talking and I really got into what Joe was talking about in this flag and what flag was flying, it really began to dawn on me that she was talking about a war mother's flag. To be totally honest, every time I hear Joe read her poem, it brings tears to my eyes. Yeah. It's very gorgeous.
It's a moving poem. It really is.
I'll start.
Right.
Oh, perfect. Pouncing.
Purple joy.
How good to be with you again.
Let us sing.
The pianissimo of the stars. Until we beat
as one.
Yay! Yay.
Very cool way to experience poetry. You can find more information on the Wick Poetry Center at kent.edu/wick. Now to our very own poet laureate of the Big Idea, NEOtropolis contributor Craig James.
Hey, Luke.
How are you?
I'm doing great.
Excellent. What is the big idea today?
I've been pondering the idea of music in the workplace.
Like in your head when you're like trying to finish a project?
Well, that's a start.
All right.
Okay, there's all kinds of different expressions. In the workplace, we use, what, words mostly, right?
Right, right.
And words can work pretty doggone well. Matter of fact, words can work great. We just learned what poetry can do.
Yeah.
It brings power to words. Well, there are other expressions, ones that are primal. You know, they hit us in the heart. Like, for example, did you know that the human smile is known at birth by
Universal.
Everyone
Absolutely.
On the planet?
Yeah.
You don't have to learn it. Well, music has that same sort of mystical, mysterious quality to it. Matter of fact, the Greeks called music art for the muses, right? But it's not just mythology.
Yeah, yeah.
There's science, too.
Yeah.
Scientists have discovered...
Anywhere in Northeast Ohio that talks about that kind of stuff you're talking about?
You're in luck, in fact, yes.
Yeah.
Here in Northeast Ohio, the Cleveland Music School Settlement is a leader in music therapy. So brain science, brain health,
right?
And when we play music especially, we use just about every part of our brain.
Mm.
And when we co-create music, we build trust.
Nice,
right?
Nice. So it's that heart stuff, right? But it's also
Plus.
The science.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah.
Heart and brain and soul.
Cool.
Right. And so this is not so much an idea as it is a challenge. I would say before every meeting, we should do a jig. We should have a jam session. We should strike a chord.
Excellent. Chord?
Wait. Oh, my gosh, a piano. Who knew?
Excellent.
Want to give it a shot?
I do.
All right, ready?
All right, here we go.
Ready?
We have
a broken piano.
We have a broken piano.
We
still have a chord of music.
The point is...
Is this the power? Should we need to turn this
right,
on? Is that what's going on here?
It's called improvisation.
All right. Well, let's see.
All right. And a one, and a two, and we are still out of luck.
Yes, we are.
So right. Here's the point.
Okay.
Okay, you can find out more
at
cat-strat.com. There's articles on brain health and music in the workplace, and stuff about the music settlement.
Excellent. Thanks so much, Craig. That was a great idea.
Excellent.
Great challenge.
Thank you.
All right. You know... One of the languages of expression is fashion. And right here in Northeast Ohio, we are inspiring future textile designers for commercial fashion industry jobs and using advanced technology to do it. Let's take a visit to Kent State's Textile Lab. Technology has changed the way we deal with fabrics and textile design in big and bold ways. I'm here at the Fashion School at Kent State, and I'm going to be talking with the director, J.R. Campbell. J.R. Campbell designs, creates, researches things about fashion and about the use of technology in fashion. There's things like digital looms and digital embroidery machines. But you know, the ultimate part of his work and anyone's work with fashion is to figure out how we present ourselves, how we take part in the world. So join me now when I talk to J.R. Campbell. J.R., how are you?
I'm great, thanks.
Thanks for being here at the Take Five questions. I don't promise I won't sneak in a couple others.
okay? So really, let's start, though. What does wearable technologies, is it like hard drive, earrings? What is it?
Well, it could be, actually. There's really been an evolution. I think, you know, at the start of the use of the term wearable technologies, it probably looked a little bit more like cyborg, you know, like how do you strap a computer onto your body and have it do something? And I think there's actually been a lot of really, both academically and sort of culturally, a lot of discussion on what wearable technology is or could be. I was actually at a wearables technology conference in Wales in 2005, and the realization at the conference there was that probably the best, most efficient, most robust wearable technology is a smartphone.
Talk to me about, you know, these machines. How did the machines that we're going to see all around here really change how we can think about fashion?
Well, okay, so the textile lab that we have in the fashion school at Kent State is intentionally here to be three things: learning and teaching space, commercial service, so we literally do offer digital textile and fashion services to the broad public, and also a space for research to occur around the use of the technologies. And the underlying premise is that essentially we're exploring technologies that formerly, at least in terms of the design processes in fashion and textiles, would have been sort of analog approaches. So in the case of printing, for instance, we're working with digital inkjet printing that is really substantially different in terms of what it offers when you compare it to the traditional screen printing or roller printing processes. So we're exploring not only just one technology, printing, but we also have digital embroidery machines, the laser cutting and etching machines. We partner with the School of Art on their use of the digitally driven looms for weaving, and we're exploring knitwear as well. The idea of being digital, the first thing, is that it allows for a big change in design approach and then in the preponderance of design, like how many designs can be created.
When you talk about, when I think of cotton and more traditional kinds of stuff, and then you inject them into a, quote, high-tech, that's kind of a trite term, but a high-tech environment, how does that push and pull? I mean, how does the relationship work?
Well, actually, I mean, I think textiles have always lent themselves to applications of new technology. For instance, the digitally driven loom was, the concept for punch mechanisms that drove Jacquard looms were sort of precursor to the punch card systems that were applied for binary computers. And so there have always been sort of a nice opportunity for interface between textile and technology. And part of that also it has to do with the fact that it's one of the few materials that we experience as humans that we are in almost complete and constant contact with our entire lives.
What is this? Some of this cool technology and cool look of here, what does that have to do with teaching students principles of design?
Well, in the context of the fashion school and also learning to think about how to integrate digital tools into the design process, what our goal here is for the students is that they are thinking both about what the design capabilities are and what the implications are for, you know, using it in the industry.
So you've told us what students should think. You know, finally, JR, what should the viewers of NEOtropolis, the tens of thousands of people out there, what should they think about fashion in terms of their own personal lives in Northeast Ohio?
If we reflect on who we are, what we're doing, where we're going, there, even as an individual who, you know, if you don't think of yourself as someone who's particularly fashionable or otherwise, inevitably,
I don't.
Inevitably, you're communicating about yourself through your clothes. These technologies are allowing me to think differently about clothing, both in terms of color and in terms of shape and silhouette. And you know, I think I'm hopeful that what they will do is get people to start to wear more creative, more, you know, just a wider variety of things. The possibilities are endless, really.
If you want some more information about what goes on here at the Textile Lab or the Fashion School, go to fashionschool.kent.edu.
You know, it strikes me that one thing I've heard about the changing global economy is the way that even if a lot of labor is outsourced, much of it in terms of research and design, like in textiles, is in the United States. And of course, a good bit of our regional economy illustrates that. It sounds like more content for NEOtropolis, especially with this guy right here, our Culture Mark contributor, Dr. Dave.
Hey, Luke, how's it going?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm fine, thanks.
So tonight we're talking about languages of expression, and we've talked about fashion, poetry, words and stuff. But, you know, the other part of words is rhetoric, like rhetoric from big institutions, politics and stuff like that. What, start us off in a conversation about that.
Oh, political language, there's an awful lot at stake. You know, language shapes our experience of reality. And just as language shapes thought, language can also corrupt thought, distort thought. I mean, we've all read 1984, or many of us. Still a staple, as far as I know.
I remember, sort of,
yeah. I don't know if they're tweeting
Orwell,
it yet,
wasn't
but
it?
It's, yeah, that
yeah,
guy. That guy. So there's an awful lot at stake in political language. What's really at stake is our hearts and minds and the direction of consciousness, awareness.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's interesting thinking about local politicians. Dennis Kucinich proposed in his last bid at the presidency, at least primary bid, that there ought to be a Department of Peace.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, I was saying that just a word change like that, of course, right? Department of Defense, Department of Peace.
We've already had the change because until 1948, it was called the Department of War.
Well, that's really
now
what
look
it is.
At the subtle shift. That's right. It's much more honest. If you call it the Defense Department, clearly it's much more easy to get the sort of population to say, well, we ought to fund defense. Right. Defense is great. Yeah. But as per Eisenhower's warning when he left when he left the presidency, of course, the military industrial complex has grown beyond all reasonable proportion. But it's one thing to pay taxes for defense, another thing for war. How different might things conceivably be, A, if you called the War Department the War Department, or B, if we demonstrated some sort of national commitment to peace with the Department of Peace?
Well, and of course, that's a huge example, and there's cuts across all sectors, though. I'm thinking of sports. Let's take sports for a minute. I was watching the Super Bowl, all the stuff. They talk about a player staying within themselves.
Yeah.
I don't know where that player's supposed to go if they're not in themselves. They're supposed to be out-of-body experience?
Well, you know what? I love sports talk, I guess. The most loaded area of all language is the areas of metaphor and euphemism, and I get a kick out of watching football games and listening to commentators who say, you know, the Browns are going to need to hit a home run here.
Really?
So now we're using other sports metaphors
we
to
can't
get
keep
at,
it within
exactly
our own.
Exactly right, yeah.
So what do you want to leave us with tonight?
Ooh, well, first off, I guess, and only respect for language. Do you ever stop to consider, Luke, that the entire story of the Western world, the creation story, is based in language. God speaks. He says, let there be light.
Yeah.
And it all comes into being. The other thing is this. One of the great contemporary social philosophers, a guy named Jürgen Habermas, points out, reminds us, that in language is always the possibility of human understanding. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't matter if we're talking about a romantic relationship or the global relationship among peoples.
Good stuff. Going to have you back, of course. Thanks, Dave.
Thanks, my friend.
Back now with Kathleen to check in what viewers had to say tonight. What's going on out there?
As always, we have great discussion happening on our Facebook page. Love this comment by Faith Dean. She's quoting Noam Chomsky. You know, if we don't believe in freedom of expression for people we despise, we don't believe in it at all.
You know what? And Dr. Dave, I'm sure, knows who Noam Chomsky is. Famous, famous guy. What else? That is a good comment. What else do we got going?
Elliot Schaefer, we've had more comments about how it's such an important right, and people don't favor limiting this, you know, in the wake of wars and terrorism.
Right. You know, I think that it's so true that it can just be a double-edged sword. All kinds of speech, you know, all kinds of things can be positively struck or negatively, and that's, you know, that's part of the beauty of language, I guess. So, how can people get in touch?
We'd love to hear from folks all throughout the week at facebook.com/NEOtropolisTV, of course on Twitter at NEOtropolisTV. Email us. We'd love to hear your comments throughout the week.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Kathleen. Really appreciate it.
Thanks, Luke.
And remember, you guys have to stay in touch, not just to communicate with us over all the social media, but check out neotropolis.org, because there you'll find all kinds of links to stuff we talked about on the show and stuff that we're considering for future shows of NEOtropolis. Now a few words about love. Mi amor, ti amo, da shori, liebe dich, con affetto. Love you, sugar. All words, all about love. It's Valentine's Day, and we are part of the money-making machinery. Cards, chocolates, flowers, candlelight dinners, and high expectations, only some of which are going to be met. One expectation that good old St. Valentine probably didn't have was to get martyred for his belief in everlasting love. The story goes he was put to death by this guy, Emperor Claudius II, for secretly marrying young people against the big boss's wishes. Today we gush and mush and swear up and down to our one and only that come hell, high water, or a better-looking prospect, we will remain true. The medley goes from Captain and Tennille's Love Will Keep Us Together to Crosby, Stills, and Nash, Love the One You're With, to Betty Everett's It's in His Kiss. Then George Benson reminds us that words get in the way. Because despite all that we can say about love, it's more about the action. The language is in the deeds and doings, big and small, that make up love poems, mean something, independent of the sounds they make. So on this Valentine Day, act with love and act love large. That's it for tonight's NEOtropolis. Join us in 2 weeks for an exploration of upcycling and using yucky waste to make beautiful energy. And during the week, once again, stay in touch in neotropolis.org, all our social media stuffs, suggest shows for the future. We'd love to hear from you. Thanks for joining us.
Funding for NEOtropolis has been provided by the following.
I'm a process engineer at a high-tech company in Ohio. We're developing cool new liquid crystal devices, like the Boogie Board tablet. It's based on technology created at Kent State University. Yeah, the research teams at Kent State are always coming up with discoveries. Discoveries that end up in real-world products. In fact, you'd be amazed at all the great things coming out of Kent State. I should know. I'm one of them. My name is Diaz McDaniel, and I'm a proud graduate of Kent State University.
The John S. and James L. Knight Foundation, supporting transformational ideas that promote informed and engaged communities.